Hello everyone, till last lecture we talked about the grouping of resistor, grouping of cells from the current electricity, and we discussed how cells in series are connected and how they produce effective voltage and effective resistance. So we discussed that if cells are connected in series, so this is how we represent a cell with a EMF and the internal resistance. And if n cells are connected in series like this manner, we said that the equivalent EMF is given by the sum of individual EMFs and equivalent internal resistance is given by the sum of effective internal resistances. Now, what are the benefits of connecting cell in series? So, we know that in series, the net voltage or net EMF is the addition of all the individual EMFs. So, net EMF is actually always greater than the individual EMF. So suppose you need more voltage, right? If you need more voltage, you will go for a series connection. Let's understand that if you have to create a 15 volt, right? If you need a source of 15 volt and you are having 5 volt battery in your hand, what you will do is you will connect 3 similar batteries in series, which makes it 5 plus 5 plus 5 and hence 15. So that is the benefit of a series connection, where you can actually get more voltage than the individual voltages. And talking about limitation, so grouping of cells also has same limitation which we saw in grouping of resistors, which basically means that if one of the cell is damaged, we won't be able to get this functioning, right? The whole chain is broken. So these are some disadvantages also for the series connection. So let's talk now about the parallel connection. So the topic is parallel grouping of cells. What is mean by parallel connection? Parallel connection basically means that between two points, all those circuits are made, right? Between two points, all the cells are connected. Parallel resistors, parallel connection resistors will involve that between two points, all the resistors are present. Parallel connection of cell basically means that between two points in a circuit, all cells will be present, which basically means across the terminals of a cell, the potential difference or terminal voltage will be constant. So let's see diagrammatically how it looks like. So let's say these are my two points, A and B, right? And if I connect cell 1 here, cell 2, cell 3, and so on, so many cells I can connect. You see, across all the three cells, we have a common voltage. Across all the three cells, we have a common voltage. So we can see here that across all the three cells we have a common voltage V, but what is difference here is the current produced by these cells. So let's say these are the three currents I1, I2 and I3 which is produced by these three cells, right? So net current which is coming out through this branch, final branch I, is basically the sum of I1 plus I2 plus I3, right? Basically the sum of I1 plus I2 plus I3. So you see that in parallel combination we have the same voltage, but we are able to get more current. So you can think of the application where you need more current at a same voltage, you will think of a parallel combination, right? So let's derive what is the equivalent EMF and equivalent internal resistance when cells are connected in parallel manner, right? So let's just take two cells for simplicity, maybe we can take more later. So let's say this is cell 1, right? This is cell 1 and this is cell 2. They are connected in parallel combination. And let's say this is some resistor here also. Right. This is cell 1 and cell 2. And let's say E1 is the EMF of cell 1, R1 is the internal resistance of cell 1, E2 is EMF of cell 2 and R2 is internal resistance of cell 2. Right. Now we need to draw an equivalent circuit for this, which basically means a one cell and one resistors across the same combination. So let's say this is EEQ, which is equivalent EMF, and this is REQ, which is equivalent internal resistance. Right. Now we know that in parallel, what is same is voltage. What is same is voltage. Right. So let's say this point is A and B, and same again, this point will be also A and B, and voltage across A and B is V. Voltage across A and B is V. and let's say this is the current from this is final current is I, which is current here also, and this is I1 and I2. Right. Now, let's find out what are these I1 and I2. Right? What are these I1 and I2? First, if I talk about this point, right? What to talk about this point? You know, for a cell, V will be equal to EEQ minus I into REQ. Right? So what is the final current here which is coming out, which basically is EEQ minus V by REQ. Let's say this is my equation 1. Correct? Now let's talk about this one. So here we have two current which is making I. I1 and I2 comes together and make I. So what is I1? I1 here is E1 minus V by R1. Same manner I can also find I1. I2 here is E2 minus V by R2, and I is nothing but I1 plus I2. You can see I is being made by I1 and I2, which is coming together at a junction and aiding and producing I. So this basically means I1 plus I2, and if you follow, you will be able to write this like E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 minus I into, not I, minus of V into 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Let's say this is equation 2. Now you see, this is equation 1 and this is equation 2. If you compare 1 and 2, you see LHS is same, which is I. Right? And if I write one more step here, this becomes EEQ by REQ minus V by REQ. And let's say this is 1. Now if you can compare 1 and 2, you'll be able to appreciate that EEQ by REQ is given by this expression and 1 by REQ is given by this expression. Now can I write the final expression? So the final expression is, let's say 1 by REQ will be 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 if you compare 1 and 2. So same as in normal parallel combination of resistors, how we calculate the equivalent resistance, here also the reciprocal of internal resistance is the individual sum of reciprocal of individual resistors. Right? And EEQ by REQ is given by E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2. So EEQ will be what? REQ into E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2. Right? And REQ, you can similarly, you can also write it like E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2. Let me write it somewhere else. And this, can I write it like 1 upon 1 by REQ? Right? Can I write it like that? Now if I find the final expression for EEQ and REQ, let's find the final expression. So EEQ will be given by E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 upon 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Okay? And REQ will be given by 1 by REQ equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. So this is the equivalent EMF in parallel and this is the equivalent internal resistance in parallel combination. Right. Now you see, this internal resistance is given by the same way we used to see in the parallel combination of resistors also. So you can say that equivalent resistance in parallel combination here also will be lesser than the individual resistors. Right. And the equivalent EMF is the given by this expression, which is summation of ratio of EMF and resistors of individual divided by the net internal resistance, divided by the reciprocal of net internal resistance, right? So let's say, as of now we had only two cells, right? Let's say if we have n number of cells, let's say we have one cell, two cell, three cell, and let's say n cell, which are connected in parallel combination. So let's say this is E1, R1, E2, R2, E3, R3, and this is EN and RN. So what is the equivalent, net equivalent internal resistance? It will be given by 1 by RN equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 till 1 by RN. Okay? And what is the equivalent EMF? So EEQ will be given by, again, the sum of ratios of E and R of individual, E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 till EN by RN, and divided by the reciprocal of resistance, which is 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by RN. And you can also remember this dimensionally if you are not able to follow which what to divide, whether we need to divide by R or 1 by R, you can think dimensionally that the final will have the dimension of E, which is volt, voltage, right? So you can think like that. So let's solve a problem on this to understand this a bit better. So we have a problem in which two cells are given in parallel. You can see this is parallel combination because these two cells are connected between points V, A and B, basically the potential VAB. So these are having a common potential VAB, hence these are in parallel. You can easily say that. Now these are connected in parallel and we need to find the equivalent resistance. So we need to replace this circuit with equivalent circuit like this. B, A, this is EEQ and REQ. So very simple, you know the formulas, you can put the values and find the answer. So let's find the REQ first. So 1 by REQ is given by 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. You know, here we have two resistances or resistors. So 1 by 1 plus 1 by 2. So this is basically what? 3 by 2. So REQ is 2 by 3, which is 0.66 ohm. So you see the equivalent internal resistance is actually lesser than both the individual resistances. This resistance is 1 ohm. This resistance is 2 ohm. Then equivalent resistance is 0.66 ohm, which is the specific nature of a parallel combination. And now, to find the equivalent EMF, we know the formula. The formula is EEQ equal to E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 upon 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Right? Can I write it also like that? REQ into E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2? Because I know the REQ here. So REQ is 2 by 3. E1 is 6, R1 is 1, and this is 3 by 2. And now you can find this. Basically, this is 15 by 2. This basically is 5 volt, not ohm. This is 5 volt. So this circuit can be replaced with this simple equivalent with 5 volt and 0.66 ohm internal resistance. Right. Now we have one more problem on this topic, which basically uses both the concepts of series and parallel together. You see this combination. In this combination, we have a combination of three cells. You see, we have three cells, cell 1, cell 2, and cell 3. Right. So, which are grouped like this, and we need to find the equivalent resistance. So, equivalent resistance, equivalent EMF, which basically means we need to replace this circuit again with simple EEQ and REQ between A and B. Now, you see, if I call this as cell 1, let's say this is cell 1, right, and let's say this is cell 2, and this is cell 3. So you can easily understand by looking at the figure that cell 2 and cell 3 are in parallel because they are between two points. And the combination of cell 2 and cell 3 is in series with cell 1. So let's forget cell 1 for now. Let's solve cell 2 and cell 3. Then we will take cell 1 into account. Right. So if I extract this part of circuit out. So it looks like 4 volt in series with 2 ohms. And again 10 volt in series with 2 ohm, and let's say between two points, let's say this point is maybe C and this may be B, like given.
Right.
And we are forgetting cell 1 for now. We will take into account later on, but for now, we are just eliminating this part and we are just seeing this parallel combination. We have extracted it out. Now we need to find the equivalent resistor and equivalent EMF here. But one tricky point, if you see, the terminals of cell is kind of placed differently. Now you see, this cell is connected in opposite polarity. This cell is connected in opposite polarity to this. So now, let's see how the formula changes. Right. So we discussed, let's forget this question for now. So we discussed that if cells are connected like this in this manner, and this is E1, R1, E2 and R2, so net EMF will be given by what? E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 upon 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Why? Because these two are producing currents which are adding to each other. These two are producing currents which are adding to each other. But in this case, or let's say, if I reverse polarity of E2, right, if I reverse the polarity of E2, now the current produced by E2 will be in this direction, opposite direction. So it won't aid the current anymore, right? So the formula will change like, E2 will be replaced by what? Minus of E2. So it will be like E1 by R1 minus E2 by R2 on 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Right. And this will be replaced by something like EEQ and REQ. Now again, one more thing to notice here is I have placed the final polarity as same as E1. Right, you see the polarity of EQ is same as E1, assuming that E1 is greater than E2 and final current is in the this left forward direction, and hence I have placed EQ as E1. But if E2 is greater than E1, this polarity will change like this. This polarity will change like this. If E2 is greater than E1, because then E2 becomes dominating and this current becomes dominating, right? So which is the case with this question? Let's solve this now. Now you can see, you can easily predict the final circuit which comes out of this will be of this nature. The polarity will be placed like this because 10 is greater than 4. 10 is greater than 4 and final current will be in this direction, and hence the polarity will be like this. Now we need to find these values, EEQ, REQ. So let's find. REQ you can easily find, 1 by REQ equal to 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2. So REQ is 1 ohm. Right, what about EEQ? So EEQ will be, let's say this is E1 and this is E2. Right, E1 and E2. You know E2 is greater than E1. So let's take it as E2 by R2. So E2 by R2 is 10 by 2, and which is 80 to the negative of E1 because this is the opposing nature. So this becomes 4 by 2 and this is multiplied by the REQ which is 1. So this is 5 minus 2 which is 3 volt. So this is 3 volt and this is 1 ohm. Right, 3 volt and 1 ohm is the equivalent combination of this parallel combination, but you can see the nature of polarity here because same we are going to replace here. Now you can see this particular whole parallel bunch of circuit can be replaced by a simple equivalent, which is like this, 3 volt and 1 ohm. Right. And let's say this is cell 4. Now forget everything we did here. Now we just see cell 1 and cell 4. Now you can see here that again equivalent resistance you can easily calculate because this is now a series combination. So REQ will be 1 plus 1 which is 2 ohm. Net equivalent resistance is 2 ohm. What about equivalent EMF? Again you see the polarity is opposing. Right. So when we can say the polarity is aiding in series and when we can say the polarity is opposing. So just understand this simple thing. So if cells are connected like this, right, that negative of first is connected to the positive of second and negative of second is connected to the positive of third, these all are connected in aiding fashion and net EMF will be E1 plus E2 plus E3. But if there is a polarity shift, if I place negative first and then positive, there is a opposition here and there is a opposition in the EMF and hence net EMF will be E1 minus E2 here. Right. So here also you can see 6 volt and 3 volt are connected in opposing fashion. Right. So net EMF will be 6 minus 3 which is 3 volt. Right. And what is the polarity of net EMF? It will be like E1 only because this is more. So EEQ, final EEQ and final REQ like this, look like this, and this is 3 volt and this is 2 ohm, right? So this gives you concept of both series and parallel as well as how polarity of cells affect the net EMF, right? Now we will solve some problems on the equivalent combination of resistors, grouping of resistors, because we missed it in the last lecture, so we will solve it here. So you see, this is a system of circuit in which resistors are placed and we need to find the equivalent resistance between points A and B. You can see point A and B, we need to find the equivalent resistance. So to solve this particular problem, let's understand that problem can be a lot complex, right? It may look very complex, but sometimes it's not that complex if we go with a proper approach, right? So let's start by naming the nodes first, right? So you see, this point is A and this is the same wire going, there is no potential change because there is no resistor, so this point is also A, right? Same you can see, this point is B, so this point is also B. So let's name the remaining nodes. Let's say this node is C and this node is D, right? Now we have named all the nodes in this circuit, right? There is no node left, right? Now if we draw the equivalent figure of this. You see, between point A and point D, there are two resistors. Because this point is also point A, and between A and D, we have this R also, and between A and D, we have this R also. And here also, you see, between B and C, we have this R also, and between B and C, we have this R also. Right. So, problem is now becoming a bit simple. So, let's draw the equivalent diagram. So, if I draw A, right, if I draw A and place two R in parallel, and then I draw this point D, correct? You understood this part? Now, if I start from the back, right, if I start from the back, this is B, and if I draw two resistors here and one here, and this point becomes what? C. This is R and this is R, correct? Now, how many resistors we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have drawn two resistors. Two are remaining. So, what do we do to the two remaining resistors here? So, now you can also see that we have a resistance between B and D. Right? We have a resistance between B and D, which is again R. And we have a resistor between A and C also, which is again R, correct? This looks fine. Now you can see that we have kind of simplified this complex circuit a little bit simple, but this also looks a bit complex. Now if you see, if we need to find the equivalent between A and B. You see how many paths we have from A to B. One is this top path and one is the bottom path. Right. One is the top path and one is the bottom path, and both are in parallel to each other. Right. So this R and R will give me what? The parallel of R and R is R by 2. You appreciate that? So this becomes R by 2. And this becomes R. And this again becomes R and R by 2. This is this R by 2. And again, if I take the points, this is D, this is C, this is hole is A, and this hole is B. Now you can easily solve this question. So what is the answer? R plus R by 2 is 3 R by 2 and 2 3 R by 2 in parallel. So R equivalent will be 3 R by 4. Correct? So you see, the problem looked a bit complex, but you don't even need to do all this. You can simply make the points, make the equivalent circuit and find the final answer. There is no calculation here. Right? So we have one more problem on series parallel combination. And you see, this is the circuit. Every individual resistance has a value capital R, and we need to find the equivalent resistance between A and B. Now you see, this question looks very complex. You can see there are a lot of resistors and things placed, and you may think that how big is the question and it will take a lot of time to solve this. But always remember that these type of questions have some basic concepts involved, and you need to figure out them before solving. So one basic concept here is, if you see that a current, if there is a current, right, if there is a current and it sees two paths, if it sees two paths like this, right, so current always takes a least resistance path, right, like everyone prefers to take a least resistance path where they get a least resistance and where they can flow easily. So current also always takes a least resistance path over a high resistance path. And if we place a short circuit between any points, the current will not enter the resistor or the load. It will just bypass from that short circuit path. Right? So you may see that you may see sparks coming out from in your homes when you touch any socket or something, because when you connect any wire to a high voltage point, you are creating a short circuit. Short circuit basically means that current will pocket other paths. It will come through that wire, because that wire is a conducting wire which has nominal resistance. In a condition like this, if a current I is there and there is a resistance and a short circuit here, the current will just bypass through this short circuit and it won't enter the resistor at all. So this is the concept of short circuiting, which basically says that current always prefers the least resistance path to traverse. Now you understand this question. You see, current, we need to find the resistance between A and B. So current will start from here and end from A. So incoming is A, outgoing is B. Now you see one thing. The current may flow like this. At this junction, you can see what can happen. Let's name the junctions. So this junction is C. let's say this is P, this is E, this is F, this is G, this is H, and this is also H, and this is also H. Right. I have named all the junctions. Now, if you see clearly, C and H are short circuited. So, basically, these are not H. These are all C. These are all C. Right? These are all C. Now, you see, the condition, the situation, how is the situation? So, there is an A. The current is entering into this resistor. This is, let's say, this R. Then there is a point C. And then there is again a point C, and there is again B, where current is exiting. And between these two points C, there are a lot of resistors connected. There is a big network. Now you tell me, as I said, the current, if this it enters a junction, it takes the least resistance. Will it even go to these resistors? It won't even care. It won't even bother. It will just bypass through this and come out of B. So what is the equivalent resistance it is seeing in the path? Which is basically R and R, which is R plus R, which is 2R. You see this big network we have, but if you know this concept, if you know this concept, you can eliminate all those lengthy calculations and tell me that net equivalent resistance basically is 2R for this circuit, which is because of this resistor and this resistor, because others are not playing any part, right? Now we will talk about this new topic called Kirchhoff's rules. So Kirchhoff's gave some set of rules which are used to deal with the complex circuits involving a lot of resistors, a lot of cells, a lot of capacitors, a lot of inductors and so many passive components. But Kirchhoff gives some simple set of rules or ideas by which you can simplify your calculations. Right. So there are two Kirchhoff's rules. We will talk about them one by one. Right. So first is current rule. Kirchhoff's current rule, which is also basically called as junction rule. So current rule, which is also called as junction rule. Junction, the word junction basically means where a lot of paths are crossing, where there is a common node for a lot of paths, right? That is basically a junction. So Kirchhoff's current rule basically states that at any junction, the magnitude or the value of incoming current is equal to the value of outgoing current. Right? Let's understand. So let's say this is the junction. You say this is the junction, and let's say these are currents coming at this junction, I1 and I2, and I3 is going. Kirchhoff said that the net outgoing current will be equal to incoming current. So I can easily write that I3 equal to I1 plus I2 according to Kirchhoff's current rule or junction rule. Right. I can easily write that outgoing current equal to incoming current, which is I3 equal to I plus I2. And how do we come at this rule? So this comes from an idea of law of conservation of charge. You know, current is nothing but flow of charge, right? So whatever amount of charge is coming through this path and whatever amount of charge is coming through this path, they are quantized, and the final charge is the sum of this charge and this charge. So this comes from a very simple idea of law of conservation of charge. So Kirchhoff's current rule basically comes from conservation of charge. Right, this is Kirchhoff's current rule. So now, a lot of questions, a lot of circuits can be simplified by this simple rule, right? Okay. So let's solve a simple problem, or let's understand a simple problem here. So let's say, if this is a junction, right? This is a junction O. Current is coming, let's say 1 ampere. Let's say this is 2 ampere. This is 3 ampere. And let's say this is X. I4, I1, I2, I3. And I4, we need to find which is X. So what is the Kirchhoff rule? Kirchhoff current rule states that whatever be the incoming current will be equal to the outgoing current. So you see, incoming currents are what? The incoming currents are current entering the junction, and outgoing currents are current leaving the junction. So at O, what are our incoming current? So we have only one incoming current, which is I1. You see, others are just going outside of O. So I1 incoming current is what? I1, which is 1 ampere. And outgoing currents are 3 currents, which is 2 plus 3 plus x, which is 5 plus x. So net Kirchhoff current rule says that 5 plus x equal to 1. So x equal to 1 minus 5, which is equal to minus 4. Minus 4 basically means that the actual current is in the opposite direction. So I4 is not basically the outgoing one. It is actually in this direction, which is 4 ampere. Right. Now you can see it is balanced. 4 plus 1 and 2 plus 3. Right. So this is the simple Kirchhoff rule, current rule, which is based on law of conservation of charge. It basically says that the sum of incoming current is equal to sum of the outgoing currents. Right. So next very important rule is Kirchhoff's voltage rule. So Kirchhoff's voltage rule is abbreviated as KVL. Similarly, current rule which we just discussed before is KCL. This is KVL. This rule is also known as mesh rule because it is applicable around mesh or a loop. Loop basically means a closed path in a circuit, right? So Kirchhoff's voltage rule says that around any closed path in a circuit, which may involve cells, resistors, anything, the net potential difference is zero. So around any closed path in a circuit, the sum of net potential difference is zero. Let's understand. So let's say this is a closed path. This is a mesh. This ABCD is a mesh. Right. So Kirchhoff's rule says that between the potential difference, the addition of potential difference between all these components in a closed path will be zero. So let's understand how it is, right? Let's say for this cell, A and C are there, incoming and outgoing points. For this resistor, C and B, let's indicate this. Let's say this is again not C, let's say this is E, this is F, this is G. So we have indicated two points. So according to Kirchhoff's voltage rule, the sum of voltage along all these individual components in a closed path is zero. So what is the voltage across this battery? This is VA minus VB across the battery. What about this resistor? It is VE minus VB. Right. What about this battery? It is VB minus VF. What about this resistor? It is VF minus VC. What about this cell? It is VC minus VG. What about this resistor? It is VG minus VD. And what about this resistor? We are going in this fashion, the clockwise fashion. And this is VD minus VA. So these are the sum of potential difference across all these components in a closed loop which starts from A and ends at A. You see, VEB will cancel, VB, VB will cancel, VF, VF will cancel, VC, VC will cancel, VG, VG will cancel, VD, VD will cancel, and VA, VA will cancel. Net potential difference is zero. So sum of net potential difference along any closed loop is zero, which is KVL, which is Kirchhoff voltage rule. And all the complex circuit, if you see, can be simplified and solved by forming equations using Kirchhoff voltage rule. We'll be solving a lot of questions on this. But as of now, you understand this is the Kirchhoff voltage rule, and this is basically dependent on the, this is the principle of, you know, in a closed path, work done is zero. Like we saw that for KCL, the concept was the conservation of charge. Here the concept is around any closed path by a conservative force, the work done is zero. And this is what we have previous, you can see, for this is a closed loop. And how we prove that how the potential difference across all components, the sum of potential difference across all components is zero here. And in next lecture, we'll be solving a lot of questions on this KVL and KCL, and we'll see how these can be used to simplify a lot of complex circuits. Till then, thanks.